Welcome. This time on Frank Buckley Interviews, an inspiring woman who is an actress, a mother, and now an author and a widow. Tembi Locke married an Italian chef, Sauro, whom she'd met while she was studying abroad. But his Sicilian family rejected her.
I was yet something else that was other,
yes.
Right? American, black. I wanted to be an actress. You know, I had divorced parents, like things that for an Italian family, they were like, what? And so they really didn't sort of, they were very reticent initially. Mm. And in fact, more than reticence, it became kind of a standoff.
Mm.
Saying we can't really condone or accept this.
Mm.
Because if we do, you know, I think to their thinking and their town, we will be looked down upon when this goes south.
But then Tembi's husband, Sauro, was diagnosed with cancer. A daughter would come into their lives. And his Italian family that had rejected her before, that Sicilian town that they were afraid would judge them, would become Tembi's salvation from the grief she was about to experience. She writes about it in the new book, From Scratch, a memoir of love, Sicily, and finding home.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
Tembi, welcome.
Oh, thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here.
I'm so excited to share your story with our listeners and our viewers. Did you capture so beautifully in your book, From Scratch, a memoir of love, Sicily, and finding home. I read the dedication to my wife, and you know, she became emotional just hearing the dedication. So I want to share that with our viewers and listeners. For Sauro, who lit the fire of love, for our daughter, Zoella, the eternal flame. Who was Sauro? How did you meet?
Well, Sauro was my husband, but before he was my husband, or while he was my husband, he was an Italian chef. And we met when I was a college student. I was in Florence studying art history. And I was 20 years old, and I'm literally walking down the street, and he rounded a corner. We bumped into each other.
Yeah.
And that collision, that intersection, right, changed my life. I didn't know it at the time that it was going to change my life, but it did.
Because you actually sort of pushed him away initially.
Yeah, a little bit. I was like, I mean, he was nice and gentle and handsome. I thought it was a chance encounter. Plus, I was only there at that time for a semester. So the idea of a relationship or anything more than maybe just being friends. And so I kind of rebuffed it a little bit, but it became really clear pretty quickly that there was something magical.
And he was really into you.
Yeah.
How did it get to from there to being a good thing? I guess I'm asking you to fast forward because your book takes us through the whole romantic journey. But maybe take us to the point that you decide that it's more than just a student fling.
Yeah. I'll tell you, it actually emerged over a series of events. But the one that I write about in the book, which I'll share, because even to this day, it still takes my breath away when I think about it, is we had this arrangement where after he finished work chefing, he would come by the piazza to the apartment I rented with a bunch of other, you know, sort of Americans and co-eds and whatnot. And he couldn't ring the bell because it was late at night. And, you know, our den mother, you know, who sort of, you know, like we were subletting from, she didn't like everybody waking her up in the middle of the night with their like pesky boyfriends from, you know. So he would wait underneath a lamppost and I would go look down at the window, and when I saw him, I would let him in. Well, one night I fell asleep, and I really fell deep into sleep. And when I woke up, it was raining. And I thought, oh my God, oh my gosh, no, no, oh no. And I ran to the window, knowing, there's no way he's going to be there. And there he was.
Standing
in the rain. Standing in the rain. And the way I talk about it in the book, which I know now, you know, he was really making love an action. He was making love steadfast, consistent, willing to show up in the face of obstacles, which emerged later in our life.
And what level did it get to?
Well, I then was willing to say, you know, let's make this work any way we can. And of course, I had to finish schooling. I had to come back to the States to finish at Wesleyan. I was studying in Connecticut at the time. And he said, you know, look, people eat all over the world. I'll go where you go. wait, what? You know, I was, and
that's
and
a lot for,
it's a lot. Yeah. It's a lot. Yeah. And, but his clarity of the vision for who we could be and the kind of relationship and love we could have, it was just unwavering. Mm-hmm. And so I really was inducted into that. You know, I thought, well, okay. He sold his interest in the bar. He was also chef. He had owned a bar at the time with mm-hmm. friends. He was chefing. I came to back to school, finished, and then we decided to start our life here in the States.
And so you get married.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, we shouldn't skim over that because you at some point have to go to Sicily.
Yes.
To meet your husband-to-be's family.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
How does he prep you for that?
Well, that was a series of ongoing conversations. And, you know, I write about this time in our lives in the book because Sato had sort of, his moving from Sicily, having been raised there, then moved to Florence to be a chef, he'd really broken from his family in the sense of career choice and, yeah. and where he was living, and they really didn't sort of get it. And so there was an estrangement, a fracture, if you will, mm-hmm. right? Sort of, I know it's not too much to say, you know, the father-son, a sense of disappointment. So when I came into his life, right, I was sort of like another way he was choosing to be different.
Mm, mm.
I was yet something else that was other,
yes.
right? American, black. I wanted to be an actress. You know, I had divorced parents, like things that for an Italian family, they were like, what? And so they really didn't sort of, they were very reticent initially. Mm. And in fact, more than reticence, it became kind of a standoff.
Mm.
Saying we can't really condone or accept this.
Mm.
Because if we do, you know, I think to their thinking and their town, right, small, rural, Sicilian town, we will be looked down upon when this goes south,
mm.
which I think was sort of the idea. So we did get married. We had a big, beautiful, fun wedding in Italy
yeah.
without his family. And then about 2 years went by. 2 years, Frank, right?
Yeah.
And I, you know, as spouses do, when you know when someone you love is suffering a silent pain.
Mm.
And I knew that the distance that was between him and his, there was a silent pain there.
Yeah.
That sometimes we talk about, sometimes we wouldn't. And I said, we have to go. We're going to Sicily. And he had the look on his
yeah.
face that you have
right.
on yours. He was like, what, what? And I said, no, we're going to go. That trip became kind of a singular moment of opening our hearts with the hopes of a big reconciliation.
Hmm.
Because at that point, I knew it couldn't be about me, Tembi, because we'd never met.
Yeah.
Right? It
right.
was more about the idea
yes.
of a son having made choices that perhaps his dad didn't agree with.
Right.
right? And I just felt in my heart, we can overcome that. What I didn't know, and what I share in the book, is that there were some behind the scenes working. So if we know anything about, and you know about Italian families, you know, they're very matriarchal.
Mm-hmm.
And when a matriarch decides she wants to see her son,
yeah, then it happens.
She's going to see her son.
Right.
And so without giving too much away, that's a beautiful moment for all of us because it became the beginning of all of our lives opening up in this gorgeous way.
Coming up.
Well, we received a diagnosis. It happened even before Zoella came into our lives.
Zoella.
Yeah, yeah. He was diagnosed quite by chance with a rare soft tissue cancer. And we had the blessing of catching it early because the prognosis for the kind of cancer he has is not particularly great.
More of my conversation with Tembi Locke when we come back. When you adopted Zoella,
yes.
How did they react to that?
Loved it. Mm. I mean, one of the things about Italian families, children are children.
Love
like,
children.
Come on.
Right.
It's like a baby.
Right.
And I remember when we first took her there, she was like 6 months old. And my mother-in-law was like, first of all, the whole town came out to see her. And then my mother-in-law was like, grabbing her, hugging her, kissing, you know. And the next thing she says, has she had pasta yet? I'm like, she's 6 months old. Like, why would she have pasta?
Yeah.
But she had pasta.
All right. So now you have Zoella in your yes. life, and you're here in L.A. You're
yeah.
working as an
mm-hmm,
actress.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You're killing it as an actress.
Mm-hmm.
And your husband is successfully cooking for all of LA, and then what happens?
Well, we received a diagnosis. It happened even before Zoella came into our lives.
Zoella.
Yeah, yeah. He was diagnosed quite by chance with a rare soft tissue cancer, and we had the blessing of catching it early because the prognosis for the kind of cancer he has is not particularly great. And I feel like that's one of the other things that I try to share in the book, is this sense of these moments that are incredibly painful. Also, there's these slivers of grace that are always around us. Because having caught the cancer so early, we were able to have what then becomes this 10-year journey. And during that journey, during a moment of remission, Zoella comes into our life, because of course we wanted to be parents. We'd always wanted to be parents. And I got to be a caregiver, which is challenging, life expanding, heart expanding, but it also deepened our marriage in a whole new way. And I found parts of myself that I didn't know I had, and I had my standing in the rain opportunity.
Yeah,
for
because
him.
We talked about that earlier, but how you were able to stand up and give back to him.
Yeah.
But what did you discover about yourself that you didn't know was in there?
I guess I realized over the course of those years that I can hold as much pain as I can hold joy. And there's not a lot that scares me. Well, a lot scares me.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm scared a lot.
Yeah.
You know, we all are,
yeah.
Right? But what I learned is that I don't let the fear stop me from leaning in to what is available to me in the moment, other than the fear,
yeah,
right? And it becomes a mindset, a way of living. Because having had 10 years as a caregiver, right, through the ups and downs of critical illness, oftentimes not knowing what was going to come next, what was around the corner, how would this surgery work out, what was this treatment going to work, this clinical trial, you're constantly in this up and down, right? So the other thing that I really had to do was really stay centered and close to myself so that I could show up for him as a partner, as a wife, show up for my daughter, as a mother, and also show up for myself. I mean, one of the things about caregiving is it's really easy to sort of abdicate all of your energy, you know, to this, this big life event, this thing that's happening, right?
You talk about this very articulately in this TEDx talk that you've done. It's called What 40 Steps Taught Me About Love and Grief. People can find it online. But what is the message or messages that you would want people to take from that?
At the end of the day, we're all going to face our trials, our tribulations, our joys. The ability to stay present and connected and lean into the love is the thing that is our salvation.
Yeah.
The only, and I can say that because I've lived it firsthand, right? I've lived with the pain of watching someone I love most in his dying hour, and years before that, critically ill, unsure. And the thing that pulled us through was this understanding that our love for each other and the desire to have each other be as fulfilled in any moment, which is going to sound sort of strange, right? How can you, in the midst of a critical illness, be fulfilled? But if you start looking for it, you'll find it. And sometimes that fulfillment is a phone call with a friend. Sometimes that fulfillment is a walk by the beach. Sometimes that fulfillment is a kiss from your kid, right? It's this simple living. And in a lot of ways, Sato taught me that, because that is a part of like the Italian way, particularly the Sicilian way also. Like the sort of simplest, like sort of like, we don't have much, but we got this.
Oh, yeah. When did you feel accepted by his family?
It almost immediately, because I think that they saw how much I loved their son, right?
Huge.
But then what began to happen over time was then we began to know each other and a kind of, and even, and I write about this after Sato's passing, a deepening of that relationship, particularly with my mother-in-law, right? That closeness, our friendship. And so that was an unexpected thing. I did not know that I would be as close to her as I am to my own mom, you know, and dad in a way. You know, I never could have imagined that, you know, those many years ago when we first met.
Still ahead. I want to end with a scene you write about, and I think it might be one of the first scenes of the book, where you are in Sicily, mm-hmm. and you have his ashes. Mm-hmm. And when you go back to that place now, what do you experience?
I go there every summer, that exact same spot, because it is a reminder of the great love. It's a reminder that I am still here, and what do I want to do with this wild and precious life that I have?
We're back with Tembi Locke in just a moment. You have, the book is from scratch, and you included recipes.
I did.
At the end of the book.
Yeah.
And these are his recipes?
They're a combination.
Or the family's recipes?
Both. Sado's recipes that I found, some from my mother-in-law, some that, you know, I researched and tweaked a little bit according
So when you're making them, are you seeing his hands?
I am seeing his hands.
Yeah.
You know what? I think he still would laugh at the fact that I have like the worst knife skills in the world. Like, I spent 20 years with a chef and I'm like, hack it away. He used to laugh. He's like, you can't even, like, you know, peel a pear. Because he did it so artfully and, you know, sort of like all this one unified piece. Yeah. And I'm like, you know. But yes, when I cook, he's very much with me.
And has it gotten better? You know, people will read this book and say, oh my God, this amazing love affair. And then he dies. And you and your daughter go on. You have, his family, but you don't have him anymore. Are you okay?
I am. And I have him in a different way. And I think that that was something I discovered in the writing of the book. Meaning, I actually thought when I started to write the book that I was going to be writing a book about, you know, sort of pulling my way through loss, which in part it definitely is. What I didn't know that I would discover in the course of writing is that Sado is with me every moment. He's in my heart. It is, he's a part of my DNA, my understanding of the world. That will never go away. And so the knowing of his love, the experience of his love, stays with me. And so to that, in that sense, I think that is the promise within this book and about grief, is that there can come a moment in which wherein you feel completely, you've integrated the loss. You still feel connected to the love, and you find a way, as they say, that the light comes in through the cracks. I'll never not miss him. Never.
Yeah.
Never. It's impossible. Yeah. It's like changing my eyes to green.
Right.
It's just not going to happen.
Yeah.
I'm never not going to miss him.
Yeah.
But I have found a way to have him, keep him close. Some of it is, I'll just make a meal that we like. Sometimes it's talking to people who knew him. Sometimes it's reading letters he wrote. You know, writing this book, in a way, was my way of keeping him close. My love for him is equal to my grief and my pain. And yet I found a way for them to live side by side. And sometimes I can belly laugh at something he said.
Yeah.
And sometimes I will deeply, you know, cry or feel sad. What happens over time, in what I have found, and I've talked to other people who are 20 years out, 10 years out, you know, and I've looked to guides, really, you know, people in the public life, but also people in my private life who have walked the path of losing someone that they love deeply, and say, what do they do? How do they find their way through? The thing that that people keep saying is that over time, those deep, heart-wrenching moments come fewer and fewer. They're there.
Yeah.
And when they come like a tidal wave.
Yeah.
But where they don't come as close together as they did initially. And I am also more prepared when they do come. I've got, like, you know, basically like the, you know, the bat phone or the presidential phone to, you know, my close group of people to say, hey, I'm having a moment.
Who'll get you through it?
Who'll get me through it?
Yeah.
And then I go on, and I think that's kind of what life is.
Yeah.
And we can't fool ourselves and think it's not.
I want to end with a scene you write about, and I think it might be one of the first scenes of the book, where you are in Sicily and you have his ashes and you go and essentially illegally take his ashes to the countryside, or maybe
possibly illegally.
Illegally.
Italian government.
Right. If you're listening, Italian government, possibly may have happened. And when you go back to that place now, what do you experience?
I go there every summer, that exact same spot, because it is a reminder of the great love. It's a reminder that I am still here, and what do I want to do with this wild and precious life that I have? And I think that's something that I'm borrowing those words directly from the poet Mary Oliver, but I'm also borrowing the spirit of it from Sado. And one of the things that he said to me was, I want you to have your life. Right? That was one of the final things he said to me. And so I'm not going to take that lightly. And I do know that I have a finite amount of time on this planet. We all do.
Yeah.
I can't shy away from that. I can't turn away from it. And what would I like to do with it? So when I'm standing there, one, I'm overcome with the beauty of the place. It's an olive orchard. There's the Mediterranean there. It's the height of summer, the smells, the sights. It's just your senses are on overload.
Yeah.
And then I also get to stand in a place that was so meaningful to someone I loved so deeply. And I can say, I am still here, and you are right here with me. What are we going to do?
That's beautiful. Well, Tembi, thank you so
much.
Thank
you, Frank. It's been such an immense pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow, you got me going there. If you'd like to hear more of my conversation with Tembi, check out the Frank Buckley Interviews podcast. It's available wherever you listen to podcasts. We have more than 150 interviews in our archives, and it's always free to listen. We read all of your feedback on social media, and we retweet some of your comments. If you'd like to join the conversation, tag me at Frank Buckley TV on Twitter and on Instagram, or post a comment on the Frank Buckley Facebook page. And if you'd like to see today's show again, go to YouTube and just search for Frank Buckley Interviews Tembi Locke. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.